Go ahead and turn with me to, since everybody's mad at me, turn with me to 1 John chapter 3. Amen. I reckon you've been around as long as I have, you learned to preach through anything. 1 John chapter 3. And if I was scared, I stayed at the house. You know. 1 John chapter 3. And go ahead and mark in your Bible 2 Corinthians chapter 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 3. And we'll go there in just a little bit. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3 and then 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Let's read from John first. We'll start in the 7th verse. He said, little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. Let me go ahead and say this. It just came to me before I get into the word, because I'm going to read it again. We are in a seeking time. We've been coming on Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday. This is 2 weeks complete. And praying 2 hours in the spirit, listening to some teaching, listening to some music, worshiping, spending 2 hours, 6:30 to 8:30, Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday. Well, we're getting very little participation on Thursday and Friday. So my thoughts are, if you won't pray 8 hours a week, would you pray 4? Well, I pray at home. You're lying. I wish I didn't have to say that. You can tell I'm in a good mood today. All right, so let's cut it back and see how it works to Monday and Tuesday this week, 6:30 to 8:30. Here again, when the church is doing something, then you ought to be a part of it. Amen. And I'll get into a little bit more of that now. But you know, we did this years ago, and we did it 3 hours a night. We did from 6 to 9, and we had 35, 40 people about every night. Amen. Why don't we have that now? Because it's called backsliding. I said it's called backsliding. I don't mean you went back into sin, but you went somewhere. 1 John chapter 3, starting in verse 7. Little children, let no man deceive you. Now, there's plenty out there trying to right now. There's people in pulpits all across this nation trying to deceive you, right? And the rest of the body of Christ. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. He that committeth sin, that is practices sin, and of the devil. You know, when you get born again, you don't sin willfully anymore. You may have some flesh to overcome, but you don't deliberately, on purpose, commit sin. You don't plan to sin. Hello? He that committeth sin is of the devil. For the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose was the Son of God manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin. For his seed, who is seed? Christ's seed, Jesus' seed, remaineth in him. And he cannot sin because he is born of God. Okay? Now, if you want to turn over to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, I'll go ahead and read there. And I think I'll start. It'll help you understand what he's saying here if I start in the ninth verse. And what Paul is doing here, he is drawing a parallel between law and grace. What it means to try to live right under the law opposed to living right out of your spirit. The people who were under the law didn't have a born-again spirit. So they had a law in front of them that they had to keep. But they couldn't keep it because their nature was contrary to the law. So therefore, their life was a life of condemnation. And so in the ninth verse, he says, for if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness excel in glory. Now you remember, And when Moses went up and he spent time with God and he came back down and the glory of God was on him to such an extent that they had to put a veil over his face because the people could not look upon him because of the glory. Well, the glory was the glory of the new birth that they could not look into at that time because they hadn't been born again. So there had to be a veil put over his face. That veil is a type and a shadow of spiritual death. Okay, they could not look into the glory that you and I have on the inside of us today because of spiritual death. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect by reason of the glory that excelleth. He's talking about the glory that's in us now. Excels any glory that came through the law. For if that which is done away, see that glory didn't stay on Moses forever. It was only for a while after he came down out of the presence of God, and then it left him. For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that which remaineth is glorious. Talking about the new birth. The new nature. Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness or boldness of speech, and not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. But their minds were blinded. Well, why were their minds blinded? Well, their minds are blinded because their spirits were dead. But their minds were blinded, for until this day remaineth the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. He's saying that the Jew today that has not accepted Jesus still have a veil over their face. They still cannot see Jesus in the Old Testament because of the law. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, that's when the Bible's read, their Bible, Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible, the veil is upon their heart. See, it's upon their heart now. Spiritual death is over their heart. Nevertheless, when it, that is the Jew's heart, shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. So even when the Jew turns to the Lord and is born again, then the veil is taken away, which would represent his spiritual death. Now the Lord is that spirit. Now the Lord is that spirit. And where the spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Liberty from what? He's talking about now the Lord is that spirit. In other words, you've been born again. You have the Lord. You have the spirit. You have the spirit of the Lord on the inside of you. And where the spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. That means you're free from condemnation. You're free from a law that you can't keep anymore. Anybody listening to me now? Amen. But we all with, talking about the believers now, but we all with open face, that is unveiled face, without spiritual death, but we all with open face, beholding as in a glass, that is a mirror, the glory of the Lord are changed. Everybody say changed. We are changed into the same image. Everybody say image. From glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. So the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit is of the Lord that's on the inside of us, is what's going to change us. Now we know this, that Paul said, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice unto God, whole and acceptable unto him, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. So what he's saying is, see, nothing is going to happen in your life until your mind changes, but your mind must change from the inside out, not from the outside in. You can put information, all kind of brainwashing in your mind, and you can, I mean, you've heard stories, you know about Jim Jones, you know about all these things. I mean, he was able to, with such charisma, to put things in these people's minds that they were willing to commit suicide. Well, guess what? That didn't come from the inside of their spirit. That came from the outside. Amen. All right. But he says that now we with open face behold as in a glass, the mirror, that is, the glory of the Lord are changed unto the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Now, I've got a little mini book back there that talks about the glory of God. Because, see, the glory of God has been so misrepresented. We think it's some kind of cloud that comes in. We think it's when you walk in the door and somebody falls in the floor because of the glory of God that's in manifestation. Or in one case, you know, the guy's up there preaching in the pulpit, splits half in two and falls one, you know, come on. And we call that the glory. No, the glory of God is in you. It is what happened to you when you were born again. Amen. Everybody say, the glory of God is in me. Now, what I want to talk to you this morning about is that there's God's image in you. God's image in you. You are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Now, we read over in John where it said that his seed remains in us. Everybody say, I have a seed in me. Now, here's what you have to understand about a seed. If you have a seed in you, that means you have an image in you. There's no such thing as a seed without an image in it. Everything starts with a seed. Did you know that you started as a seed? You at one time, you existed, but you existed in a little bitty, titsy, witsy, little bitty seed. Amen. And everything that you are today was in that seed. In that seed, if you got brown eyes, you had it in that seed. Amen. If you got brown hair, it was in the seed. If you're tall, it was in the seed. If you're short, it's in the seed. Amen. And we know the word says that everything produces after its own kind. So everything started with a seed. Guess what? You started with a seed in the natural physical realm, but you also started with the seed in the spiritual realm. Amen. All right. Now, the word of God tells us that Jesus was called the seed. You remember Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, when God told the devil, he said, I'm going to put enmity between your seed and the woman's seed. Well, I got news for you. Women don't have seed. But this woman by the name of Mary did, because she did not have a physical man to deposit a seed on the inside of her. So the seed that was put on the inside of her came from God. Jesus started with a seed. He started with an image. Are you listening to me? Now, you know, when you talk about seeds, you could also replace that with the word images, and you wouldn't change the scripture at all. So Jesus is called the Word made flesh, or you could say Jesus was the seed made flesh, or you could say Jesus was the image made flesh. See, Jesus at one point in time was an image. Amen. Just like you were an image. So Jesus is called the seed. The Word of God is called the seed. Every word of God has a seed in it. Every word of God has a seed in it, and whatever that seed is determines what it's going to produce or is capable of producing in your life if you handle it properly. Amen. So the word of God is called seed, and you and I are called seed, and you and I, very clearly we read it, we have a seed in us. So if we have a seed in us, then we have an image in us. God, when you were born again, God deposited on the inside of you an image. He deposited a seed, and in the seed was an image. And the purpose of the seed, the purpose of the image that was placed on the inside of you, was for the purpose of you becoming just like the image in the seed. The purpose for which God put the seed in you is for the purpose of you becoming the image that was in the seed. See, you weren't conceived by your father and mother so that you could stay a baby all your life. Amen. All right. So then we have a, everybody say, I have a seed in me.
I have a
I have an image in me. Now the word talks about the image of Christ in the 8th chapter of the book of Romans. He talks about the image of Christ. See, on the inside of you, what is that seed? It said it came from Christ. That's what we read, wasn't it? It came from him. Amen. His seed. Everybody say his seed. His seed remaineth in us. Amen. So see, all of us as members of the body of Christ, all of us were already in existence in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now we are the body of Christ. Amen. Means that every one of us, we have an image on the inside of us that is to produce exactly the image that God put in us. Are you getting it now? Amen. And so here we are. We have an image on the inside of us. You know, an apple has the image of an apple seed. You know, the Bible says the sower soweth the word. You could say, and he likened it to seed, right? He said he soweth the seed. That was the parable. Then he said the sower soweth the word. The sower soweth the seed. You know what you could say? The sower soweth images. The sower soweth images. Or you could say pictures. That's what a sower does. That's what I am trying to do this morning, is give you an image. I can't give you the image that you already have on the inside of you, but I can give you an image of the fact that you have an image on the inside of you. Amen. Now, the image that's on the inside of you, and everybody has one. Everybody that's born again has an image. It's the image of Christ. But not everybody has the same image of Christ, because Christ is a many-membered body. Using the analogy of the body of Christ, then you could say this. If you have the image on the inside of you, the image of a hand, then see, that's what God purposed for you to be in the body, a hand. Isn't that right? If God wanted you to be a foot in the body of Christ, then he planted in your spirit when you were born again a seed which had the image of a foot in it. Amen. But here is the sad part. You knew there had to be a sad part, didn't you? I mean, it's been too good too long here. But see, here's the sad part. That image of what you are designed by God to become, that image can lie dormant on the inside of you and never produce anything. You can live as a Christian, live your life out, and never produce the fruit and never manifest the image that God put on the inside of your spirit. See, the responsibility for that image is yours. It is your responsibility to discover it. I said, it is your responsibility to discover it. It is your responsibility to protect it. It is your responsibility to water it. Seeds have to have water. It is your responsibility to nurture it. It has to have any seed has to have certain nutrients and so forth. That the stewardship of that image that God put on the inside of us, that stewardship is ours. We are responsible. That's why that so many people, they're going to lose their reward. See, when you stand before the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will stand before the judgment seat of Christ, you're not going to be rewarded based on all of the good stuff you did. I know what it says. He said every man will be judged according to the deeds done in this body. Well, the deeds can be either good deeds or God deeds. It's just like I said the other day, Eve saw the tree in the garden. She saw that it was good. The biggest enemy to God is good. And see, that image on the inside of you can be blocked and hindered by a preconception of what you are already supposed to be. See, religion can take you and make you religious. You're born again, and what happens is you come into a church, and if that church is religious, then you're going to conform to what's in that church, and you will just stay there in that church. And staying there in that church does not necessarily mean that you're ever going to manifest the image that's on the inside of you. As a matter of fact, a lot of churches don't even tell you there is an image on the inside of you, and they certainly don't tell you how that you can cause that image to be manifested in your life. Amen. So that image is your responsibility, but you got to know where to look for it. Where is that image? It's not in somebody's prophecy. Could be a confirmation to it. Amen. Your image is not in somebody else. The image that God placed in you is different than the image he put in me. See, the image that he put in me when I was born again was the image of an apostle. See, when I was born again, just like what you see in the physical here, that's what I was in a seed. I was an image. This image already existed in a seed, in my daddy's seed. Amen. Well, as a believer now and as part of the body of Christ, I already existed in Jesus. See, spiritually speaking, I have his DNA. Didn't he say? He said his seed. His seed remaineth in us. But Christ, again, is a many-membered body. So you might not be, and probably not. The image on the inside of you is not the image of an apostle. Now, see, here's the thing. If I could have stopped, and still can, and you can, and some of have, you can stop any place you want to along the road of manifestation. See, I was a pastor. The image on the inside of me was apostle. I would be much more respected and much more accepted if I had just stopped at being a pastor. I wouldn't have near the warfare and have to go through near the hell that I've been through if I'd have just stopped and been a good little pastor. And this is not a reflection on pastors, because some, that's the image that's on some people, is the pastor. And I know some good ones. Amen. But see, that wasn't for me. And so I tried to, for years, be a pastor when the image on the inside of me was apostle. And it was like washing your feet with your socks on. It just didn't feel right. Amen. Well, you're not an apostle, but there's an image on the inside of you, just like there's an image on the inside of me. Now, this is what we don't want to accept. You can accept that Apostle David has to fast and pray and seek and go through warfare and do all. You can understand that I have to do it, and you understand that I had to do all of that for that image to come forth in my life. That's possible. He had to pray all those hours in other tongues. He had to do all that fasting. He had to meditate the word. He had to feed on the word. He had to do this. He had to fight the battle. He had to do all of that so that that image of who he is could come into manifestation for all to see. But this is what you don't like. You don't like the fact that whatever your image is, you got to fight the same fight. Whatever you are, if you're going to be a hand, then you've got to pay the price for the hand to be manifested, for you to become manifested hand. We say that some people have to do it, but we don't have to do it. See, you can stop anywhere along the way. See, an apple seed was not designed by God just to be a tree. As a matter of fact, the Bible teaches you that if you take a seed, put it in the ground, it grows up and all it is a tree and it doesn't produce any fruit. He says, cut it down. Why let it cumber the ground? Why let it use oxygen? Why let it take the nutrients out of the soil that could be used to produce a tree that produces fruit? And you know where some of you are? Let me tell you, you're satisfied with being a tree. Because, see, you're not producing fruit. Hello out there. You just look good. Trees look good. Amen. So you can stop anywhere along the way. Now, see, here's the thing. If you're going to, the responsibility is yours of what you do with that image, because it is in there, whether you want to believe it or not, it's in there. Whether you ever do anything or not, it's in there. And religion has not made a place yet for everybody's seed, for everybody's image. A lot of people don't believe in apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. They don't believe in the ministry of giving. They don't believe in the ministry of helps. They don't believe in the ministry of administration. They don't believe in the baptism of the Holy Ghost with evidence of speaking in other tongues. They stopped way back there somewhere. The Bible says, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. That's the problem. People don't want to die. But the only way you can ever produce fruit is you got to die. He puts it in the ground. It's got to go in the ground. The seed, the image has got to go in the ground. It's got to stay there until it dies. And then it brings forth the blade, then the ear, then the full corn in the ear. Well, you can live as a blade, or you can live as an ear, or you can live as a full corn in the ear. You get to choose. Jesus said it this way, 36 and 100 fold, 30, 60, 100 fold. Amen. It's true anyway. The sower soweth the images. As a matter of fact, if you look at that same parable a different way, the sower, Jesus himself, sown the images. He sowed the images to the whole body of Christ, so that every member of the body of Christ has an image on the inside of them. All right. So if you're going to be the full expression of that image, see, that's what Paul was talking about when he says coming to the measure of the fullness of the stature of Christ. In other words, the seed that's on the inside of me. He was ministering that to Ephesians. He's saying the same thing. The seed that was put on the inside of me, the fullness. See, Jesus was the fullness of the Godhead bodily. What did that mean? That mean that the seed that God put on the inside of him, he was a very seed, and he came into full manifestation. That's why Paul could say, you know, I have fought a good fight, I have kept the faith, I've finished my course. Amen. Why? Because he knew what to do. Paul knew what to do. He knew what to do so that image that God placed in him could come into full manifestation, and he could be, everybody say be, that he could be the image that was on the inside of the seed. All right, so that being the case, if you're going to see the full manifestation of that seed, or if you're going to become that image, then you got to know where to look. I said, you got to know where to look. And you know where it's at. It's inside your spirit. It's not out yonder somewhere. It's not in somebody else. It's not in some religious setting. Amen. That image is in you, and you have to know where to look. Now, if I know where to look, because Colossians 1:27 says that it's Christ in me, You could say the seed in me, the image in me, is the hope of glory. Let me say it this way. The image in me is the image of my hope for the fulfillment of the image. If I don't have Christ, the image, on the inside of me, then there's no way he can be manifest in my life. Hello out there. So Colossians 1:27 says, Christ is in me, the hope of glory. All right. So then if I know where it's at, I know it's in my spirit. And guess what? I know where it's not. It's not in my head. So if my image of what God wants me to be is in my spirit, then here's the question. How do I get it from my spirit into my life? How do I become what God purposed for me to be? How do I become the image that's in my spirit? How do I get there? How do I get there? Well, in some circles, you have to, you know, give up your jewelry. Women can't wear pants. You can't cut your hair. You can't do this. You can't do that. You can't do the other. And so that's supposed to cause you to be able to manifest the image. That's got nothing to do with anything. That's all. Those are natural things. This is in your spirit. So how am I going to get in my spirit? How I got to get somewhere in there and get that thing out. Amen. So it's fully manifested. And so I become what God wants me to come, because it's only when I become what God has purposed for me to come can I do what God purposed for me to do. I got to become first. I've got to become that image before that image can do anything. And that image, let me tell you something, that image on the inside of you always involves the other members of the body. Don't want to get ahead of myself here, but let me tell you something about that image. If it's in your spirit, then it has to be prayed out. Why? Because God can do nothing except in answer to prayer. And if you don't pray it out, it'll never come out. And I don't know, I know where your thinking goes, my thinking goes. Well, what about all these wonderful people? These preachers don't speak with tongues, but they're doing all this great stuff. Doesn't mean they're doing God stuff. The Shriners Hospital is doing great stuff. You know them kids? I see them advertised on TV, them kids, you know, break your heart. But I'm glad somebody's doing something about it. Amen. But that's a good thing. I don't know that the person who started that would do it as a God thing or not, but it's still a good thing. I'm glad for some good things, but it's only when the good things take the place of the God things that it becomes a problem. Amen. So you can just by nature or just, you know, do a lot of good things, but you'll never have the fullness of the image manifested in your life until you pray it out, and you got to know how to pray it out. Now, that's a problem. I don't know what the image is, and how in the world am I going to pray out the image if I don't even know what the image is? I had no idea that I was going to be an apostle. I had to pray it out. How did you pray it out? I didn't say, Father, make me an apostle. Let me be an apostle. Lord, I want to be an apostle. That's called insanity there. Amen. God, please make me an apostle. Please make me this. Make me that. Give me this. Give me that. I didn't know what to pray for, as we ought. That's what the scripture says in Romans chapter 8. We don't know how to pray for as we ought. That's why he gave us the spirit, that he makes intercession for us according to the will of God, according to the design, according to the image. So if he give us the gift of praying in other tongues, and it's praying, it's our very spirit praying, it's not your head praying, It's not even Holy Ghost praying. Even see, the Holy Ghost knows the plan of God. The Holy Ghost is God, and so he put that image on the inside of you. Amen. But you don't know what it is. And so, but he has to use your spirit to pray it into manifestation. Because you can't pray and believe for something that you can't see, that you don't know. You don't even know how to pray. The way I became, see, I'm familiar with the church and praying in tongues, praying in tongues, praying in tongues, praying in tongues. That's about all they teach. That's all they teach. Well, see, here's a problem. I prayed out the image. I became what I was praying out. And then I'm not accepted. Because we want to do is just keep praying out the image. No, at some point in time, you got to become the image that you're praying out. If you're hungry for it, and you got to do it from the inside out. The renewing of the mind, it's not done by putting information into the mind. And he says the renewing of your mind, he wants your mind renewed to the image that's on the inside of you. That's when Paul said we're changed from glory to glory as we look at what's in us. When the more we look and know that the image is on the inside of me, and the more I focus on that, he said it's like a mirror. What are you doing? You're looking at yourself in the spirit. You're looking on the inside of you. And the more you do that, the more transformed you become. The more the image begins to take place in your life. It doesn't happen all at one time. First the blade, then the ear, and then the full corner in the ear. Some people give up because they get tired of waiting. So thank God, you don't know. You have no idea, see? If you believe what I'm saying right now, you couldn't put the people in this room on a Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday, and Friday. And you couldn't do it. If you had any revelation of what I'm telling you right now, I am telling you right now that I am where I am. I know where I came from. I know where I'm at. I know what this church was when I started going to another level of prayer. I've always been a prayer, always. But when I went to a whole new level of prayer in 1993, honey, then you can look around, because this thing was already on the inside of me. This image of what you see now was on the inside of me. Who I am and what I am and what I'm preaching right now was all on the inside of me. But I can testify to you in the English language today, honey, I prayed it out. I didn't get it in Bible school. I didn't get it by reading books. I didn't get it by asking somebody how you do it. I got it from the Holy Ghost on the inside of me. I prayed it out. It was my stewardship. It was my responsibility. God's not going to pray it out for me. I prayed it out. And so therefore, amen, not only came my ministry, but also came the prosperity and the blessing of God. I can't make it work for anybody on planet Earth, but I can make it work for me. Hallelujah. So I can pray out that image. It's called praying in other tongues for personal edification. And the next thing I know is I've got to feed on the word, because it is the word that water. You know, the Bible talks about the washing of the water of the word. Water, water. Seeds have to have water. So I've got to water my seed. If I don't water my seed, if I don't do something for my image, then my image is not going to grow. It's just going to lie dormant. So I've got to feed it on the word of God. So, okay. You're going to like this one. You know what I have to do? If I am going to become a manifestation of the image that God put on the inside of me, I have got to have fellowship. I have got to have relationships with other people who have images. and that have an understanding of that, that can help me with my image, you will never, ever, ever, ever completely fulfill the image that's on the inside of you by yourself. Because any time that God purposes to do a thing, he always creates a relationship. He sent the apostles out two by two. There always has to be a relationship in order for your image to come into manifestation, because there's something in somebody else that you need. Some of you, I mean, we even have, sometimes we have fellowship suppers or something like that. Some of you jump up and run. You can't have a relationship with anybody. You need to get fixed. The reason you can't have a relationship with anybody is because you're not praying. If you prayed out that image on the inside of you, you would know you would have to connect with other people. So don't come telling me a bunch of foolishness about you pray. I've been doing this long enough to know I can tell when people pray and when they don't. I can tell who's praying and who's not. And what's really fun is when they get to talking about their prayer life. It's real. Hallelujah. You can't pray multiple hours in the other tongues and stay stupid. You can't pray multiple hours in the other tongues and stay sorry. You can't keep on praying in other tongues and be disobedient. You can't keep on praying in other tongues because, see, you gotta walk in love, and you can't tell me you're praying if you're not walking in love and if you're not walking in forgiveness. Hello out there. Because the Holy Ghost will give your spirit a prayer to pray that will cause you to line up with the Christ in you, the hope of glory, and he walks in love and all of these other things that I mentioned. Isolation is absolutely destructive. Separation from the rest of the body is destructive. It's deceiving. There is so much deception. When you are isolated, you can believe, the devil can tell you anything he wants to. And you'll swallow it, hook, line, and sinker. See, the Bible says that counsel in the heart of a man is as deep water, but a man of understanding will draw it out. There's something in others that you need, but you'll never know it. I know, I've said this before, you know, some people don't believe in women preachers. Well, everything that's in that woman's spirit that God put in there for you, you'll never get. Unless you are connected, unless you have a fellowship, unless you have a relationship with others in the body of Christ, then you'll never come to fruition. There's no way. Anytime there's fruit produced, there has to be some kind of relationship. A seed has to have a relationship with the ground. So it takes the ground and it takes the seed to produce the fruit. You see, we live, this is what's crept into the church. People used to know one another. You know, one of my joys and my delights, you know what it is? Maybe I go into a grocery store and I have to be careful because you have to know when to shut it off. You have to know who's listening and who's drawing it. And you got, you know, so, but it rarely ever happens that anybody pays you any attention. But I love to talk about the way it was back in the 50s. See, the 50s, now the biggest problem with the 50s was segregation. But there was a lot of good things in the 50s too. And see, most of you in this room, all you know about the 50s is what you learned in our brainwashing institutes. That's all you know. Why? Because you didn't live there. I did. I lived through the 50s. Ask me something. I can talk. I mean, honey, let me just tell you. Back in the 50s, a 10-year-old boy could just stick out his thumb every day. Amen. And people would come by and pick him up and give him a ride. And not one time in 5 or 6 years did anybody ever say or do anything inappropriate. Amen. Or try to molest you or anything else. I lived it. I did it. I started when I was 10 years old. I joined a little league and didn't have any way. See, it wasn't like it is today. You just say, Mama, take me, Daddy, take me, and they jump and holler. I mean, they just start taking you. No, if I was going to play little league baseball or football or anything else, Royston was 5 miles away, and that's where they did it, and I had to get from where I was to where I was going, and the only way I had to do it was to walk and hitchhike. I have walked it the whole way. But back then, you didn't have to worry about that kind of stuff. That was a good time. It was a good time. I went through, there's a section called Harrison, Georgia, right down here. It's a community, not a town. But Harrison, in Madison County, Harrison, that's what they call it. And there was 5 or 6 little stores in a 2.5 mile stretch. My Uncle Alvin Coker had one. Gordon Vaughn had one. Pullum had one. Harmon Drake had one. Mr. Sorrells had one. I think I named most of them. But they're all gone now. But outside of those stores, in the front of those stores, were benches. And people would go to the store and sit down on those benches and talk to one another. Happened all the time. All of them had benches out in front of the store. People sat and talked to one another. They knew their neighbors. People back then would help one another. My stepdaddy, his mama and his daddy both were down with the fever. And he's trying to get a crop in the ground before it rains. And he's got to do it by himself, plowing with a mule. He gets up early as he could, as soon as he can see, and he starts plowing. He's out there, he's wringing wet with sweat. He's got, then one of the neighbors go by, and a little bit, he goes back by, and in a little bit he comes back and walks out in the field and starts talking to him. And he's thinking, man, go on, please. I don't want to be rude, but what are you doing standing here talking? I got to get this crop in the ground. It's got to be done. It's going to rain. And that's what you lived back then. You lived out of that crop. If you don't have a crop, you don't have nothing to eat. Amen. And so as he stood there and talked, after a little while, he looked up. And here come another man with a plow and a mule. A little bit, here come another one with another plow. And before it was over, they had about 5 different mules out there. 5 different people in the community was out there helping him plow that ground. It was a good time. I don't care what they tell you in the Brainwashing Institute. I lived it. It was a good time. Was there some bad? Yes, there was. But it was a good time. But we don't do that anymore. What we do now is, I ask him, I say, my God, I'm sitting here talking to you. What are you doing? How can you do this 24 hours a day, or at least every waking hour? Are you doing this? Why are you doing it? Who are you talking to? See, that's the problem. They're not talking to anybody. When you send a text, guess what? You don't hear my voice. So you don't know the fluctuation in my voice. You can't see my countenance. You did you know that about 80% of communication is nonverbal? And so did you know that you can't see my body language? You can't hear my voice? All you're seeing is words. And let me tell you this. I saw this on the internet. Every once in a while, they have something really good on there. But this guy was saying that this texting thing releases endorphins and dopamine in your brain, and it is addictive. When you see kids going around doing this all the time, they've got an addiction. It does the same thing that alcohol does, that drugs do. Amen. They're addicted to that thing. Amen. Have you ever seen it? You're sitting here and you're not even talking to one another. I've seen it. They got two people sitting in the same room and they're texting one another. They're not talking to one another. Now see, here's the thing. See, you're just reading words. You're not hearing the voice. Now let me show you how that comes over into the church. Because of familiarity. Y'all come in and you hear the word, but you don't hear the voice. You hear the word of the Lord, but you don't hear the voice of the Lord. See, Jesus said, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. When God knocked Paul off of the horse, Saul then knocked him off the horse, he heard God's voice. The rest of them thought it thundered. What we have in here Sunday after Sunday is a whole lot of thunder. Because see, you're hearing the word. There's no way that you could stay the way you have been for the last 10 years with the word that you have, that's here. Honey, I may not be good I might not have the best delivery. I might have the best charisma. I might not have the best vocabulary. But honey, I minister the word of God. And here's the problem. We're not hearing the voice because you think, because of familiarity, you think that you're hearing the voice of Apostle David. And it doesn't make any difference what I say and how much it comes out of the scripture, how great a revelation it is. It doesn't matter at all, because if you didn't hear the voice of God, it's not going to change you one bit. He said in Hebrews, today, if you will hear my voice. Jesus said, my sheep know my voice. Not my word, my sheep know my voice. Do a study on the voice of the Lord. You can hear the word of the Lord and never hear the voice of the Lord. Come on now. I mean, you know, people can read the Bible. I've heard, I haven't seen it, it's hard for me to believe, but I've heard it time and again, that people with a photographic memory can just memorize the Bible and quote every word. Never change their life. Ezekiel said, you come to hear me and say, what is the word of the Lord? And all you're saying, all you're looking for is somebody who plays well on a harp and sings a pretty song. Because you hear, but you don't do. I said, because you hear and you don't do. That's why somebody can walk in here, get saved, get fired up for God, because they're looking, they're not just hearing the word, they're hearing the voice, and they can outrun you. That's right. To God. You're never going to become the image that's on the inside of you until you start hearing God. and start showing respect for his word and for his voice. You see, if you don't pray, which is the problem, basically, if you don't pray, you won't hear a voice. You'll hear a voice, but not the voice. You can hear something. It's like when I go to Nicaragua and somebody comes up to me and starts speaking Spanish, there's nothing wrong with my ears. I know they're speaking. I hear what I hear, but I don't understand what they're saying. I can't do what they're saying because I don't know what they're saying, even though I can hear them. So that is the frustration of some ministers. Of course, not me, but some. And I don't know. I asked them in prayer yesterday, what can you do about familiarity? I don't know. I guess I could just like slip out, never speak to anybody, never communicate with anybody, slip in, slip out. But y'all wouldn't like that either. The Bible said when the Spirit of the Lord comes upon you, Saul, you'll be turned into another man. The man that's under the anointing, see, this is what you don't understand. And this is why I know me better than you know me. And I know that the revelation that I have preached today, I know that that's God. And the reason I know that it's God, and not only what did the revelation come from God, but the anointing and the ability to communicate it came from God. And the reason I know that is because I know me, and I know I can't do that. But you see me do it week after week after week after week, and then you think it's me. I know me. Because see, you're never going to do the word if you're hearing me. You'll only do it if you hear God. And your hearing is your responsibility. It's not my responsibility to hear this for you. It's not my responsibility to change you. It's not my responsibility to cause your image to come into manifestation. He called me to minister to you and to equip you. And some have been equipped. You can see it in their life. You're never going to come to that place of that image being manifested in your life if you're not willing to work. See, you don't start out. I didn't start out as an apostle. I started out just preaching, maybe in a little home group. See? I did what I knew to do. That's why in this church, there's so many opportunities for ministry right here. And yet Friday night, we had two vans that didn't run. That means there's two vans full of people that could have come and heard the word of God and might have received no matter what, no telling what, but they did not get to come because we don't have enough drivers because somebody is not hearing God. Anytime God chose anybody for anything great, he always went to somebody that was busy doing something. He never called anybody laying on the couch. He never called anybody, amen, sitting at home watching TV on Gideon group night. He never called anybody at the beach or at the lake, amen, when they're having services at the church. He never called anybody, see, during seeking time. He never spoke to anybody that's laying at home doing nothing. That's just not his mode of operandi. Did I say that right? Modus operandi. Thank you. So don't be whining to me about, I don't know what the Lord want me to do. I lost the vision. I lost this. I lost. Well, why'd you do this? It's your responsibility. If you lost the fire, if you lost the vision, I tell you why you lost it. It doesn't mean anything to you anymore. It's not important to you anymore. It's not valuable. I can see during this seeking time, this church doesn't value prayer anymore. We used to, but we don't value prayer anymore. We don't value praying in tongues anymore. We've done heard it so much, and I've had people tell me, well, I never thought that was something I needed to do. Are you crazy? Oh, I mean, I can just see you. You're so full of God. You're so full of power and might and anointing, and you're getting so many saved. And I'm telling you, well, your whole world is changing because you don't need to do it anymore. I salute you. I need to do it. Because I'm not where I'm going. I said, I'm not where I'm going. I still got breath. I'm still alive. I'm still on my feet. Amen. I'm not going to just be settled. I'm not going to be satisfied with just being a tree. I'm not going to be satisfied with two or three little Mickey Mouse apples that don't come to fruition. I want my apples, I want my fruit to be the best that they can possibly be for the kingdom of God. Well, you got to do what's, you got to, I've always said this, and this is the way I've always operated. The way I got into the ministry is if I'm sitting at the house and I ain't got no place to preach, feeling sorry for myself because of the way life is for me, you know what I do? I do something. God can bless something. He cannot bless nothing. What was you expecting this morning anyway? I don't like that. What'd you come to hear? You go home and turn TV on and there'd be a guy grinning at you, telling you how great you are and how everything's going to be all right. Is that what you expect of me? I don't think so. Well, how do you survive to me this many years? Mark chapter 4, it'll tell you what'll happen to the seed. The image, everybody say image. Because the image is in the seed. Jesus sowed the image. I'm sowing the image this morning. Well, number one, hardness of heart. Number two, affliction and persecution. Number three, cares of this life and lust of other things. The deceitfulness of riches, those things will steal your image. Come on, guys. Everybody's been hurt. Everybody's been wounded. Everybody's had a reason to quit. Everybody's had a reason to slack up. What I've been through for the last 3 years especially, you don't think there's some wars that go with that? I'm here preaching the same Bible, same word I was 10 years ago or 15 years ago. Nothing changed. My call hasn't changed. Come on. Only way somebody else's life is going to be changed is when you give yours. You find it in Colossians chapter 1. The only way that your life was changed was because Jesus gave his life. And probably somebody gave their life when they came and witnessed to you, or you went to a church that somebody built, that somebody paid the price for, that some pastor stood up and preached the word to you that the deacons couldn't stand, and the rest of them, matter of fact, they might have run him off the day after he preached to you, but you got saved because somebody paid a price. He's already went through hell just to stay there. The man that was preaching when I got saved, they ran him off. I'm glad they didn't run him off before I got saved. Because when I went to the altar, that man ran down there. I was, 10 years old. He put his arm around me and prayed for me just like I was a millionaire. Stand up with me. Somebody said a word, the truth never hurt anybody. Are you crazy? The truth hurts a lot of people that don't, won't do it, that don't want it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I love you this morning. I thank you for helping me. I did the best I could. I did the best I could. I pray, God, that the people heard something different than my voice. Hallelujah. We'll know. We'll know. We'll see. We can always tell what people are hearing by what they do. Hallelujah. We can tell what they're hearing by how they pray. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want to reiterate it again. I mean, there was a time in my ministry when I wanted people to do things so bad that I would just try to beat them into it. I found out that didn't work. I was walking right across here one morning on a Sunday morning. Miss Bobby Jean and I were walking right across here. And I looked, and it's like it is a lot of Sunday mornings. I mean, there's hardly anybody here. At 10 o'clock. I mean, if it had been something else, it had been some kind of ball game or something like that, they'd been there on time. But, and I said to Bobby Jean, I said, my God, I said, you know, these people drag in here late. You know what she told me? She's learned something. She said, yep, and says there's no thing you can do about it. You can get up here and talk about it and fuss about it all day long, and it won't. People gonna do what people wanna do. Mickey had a lot of acquaintances that was in the drug scene with him. A lot of low quality people, drug addicts, thieves, liars. But something happened to him. He said, I can't do this anymore. I don't want to do this anymore. I'm finished with this. God transformed him. Not one of the others that he's tried to help has been transformed in any shape or form. Why? Because they can still live with their self the way they are. They can live a life of sin and worthlessness and still enjoy it. Some people can. So you're fooling yourself if you're waiting for some people to hit the bottom. Because some people, they don't care nothing about the bottom. They'll just wallow around in the bottom and stay there till they die. It's only when you say, 1993, before all this, I can't do this anymore. I can't live this fruitless life. I can't live coming in here preaching every Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night, and nothing happening. Nobody getting saved. Nobody getting filled with the Holy Ghost. No new people coming into church for 6 solid years. I can't take this anymore. And when I got to the place that I couldn't take it anymore, I gave God something. There was something that happened that God could take hold of. He could grace me and help me to press my way in. It'll work for anybody. I don't care who you are. I don't care what your ministry is. I don't care what part you are in the body of Christ. It will work for you if you will do it. But you're not going to do it until you get sick and tired of the way you are, the way you're living at any level.